William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Cutting Room, a novel by Ashley Dyer, performed by Peter Noble. Prologue. A man strides down a moonlit alley, his heels echoing like stones dropped on cobbles. He's 22 or 23, young enough to take his invulnerability for granted, perhaps. He is yet to learn that a lone male walking the back streets of Liverpool is never as safe as he imagines. The cocksure swagger that shields him from hard cases and shadow creepers this side of night cannot protect him from the hooded figure who waits, unseen, in a doorway. He senses the presence, and in a practiced glance that would serve as warning in the bars of better-lit, more populous streets, he sees the figure, and a tremor of uncertainty passes quickly over his face. Is it the stillness of the strange apparition that makes him miss his stride, or perhaps the facelessness of the threat? Darkness seems to fold in on itself in this quarter at this hour, and neither eyes nor a face are visible under the hood. The figure steps out into a thin slice of moonlight, and the young man's shoulders twitch as if a finger has traced the length of his spine. He takes his hands from his pockets and readies himself to fight or flee. He's not afraid of face-to-face confrontation, but this threat is sly, insinuating. It matches his footfalls, echoes the echoes of every step he takes. Fear seeps into his heart. He quickens his pace, but the hooded figure casts a long shadow. Darkness seems to ooze from it like evil intent. The shadow creeps closer and closer, flowing like poured smoke. He half turns as the shadow catches his heel, and his eyes flash with fear. The shadow engulfs him. Darkness falls. The lights go up. A man stands on a semicircular stage. The camera pulls back to reveal a studio audience. It switches to an overhead view. A second camera swoops in on a wire, focusing on the man, as the screen behind him becomes awash with binary code, running down the screen like water. I am Professor Mick Tennant, and this is Fact or Fable. The presenter is tall and lean, his grey hair at odds with the youthful energy that seems to crackle off him. A ticker tape crawls along the bottom of the screen, revealing the episode title. Statistical uncertainty. Learn to think outside the box. Liverpool is a city in fear, he says over the audience's applause. In just 6 months, 12 men aged between 22 and 28 have vanished without a trace. The back screen lights up, and images of the missing appear in succession, their faces expanding on the screen for a brief, bright moment before vanishing again into the darkness. Theories abound, Tennant says, a time slip which transports the missing back in time. As if the audience couldn't possibly imagine this preposterous scenario, the screen runs a clip of a male actor, his back to the audience, walking toward a busy street corner in the Liverpool city centre. As he reaches the intersection, his image fractures in lines of interference, and he vanishes. Criminal gangs who prey on the vulnerable, stealing their valuables and disposing of the bodies. As this second reconstruction fades, Tennant pauses. Now, a new contender, a sinister figure locals call the Ferryman. An image of the faceless hooded figure looms like a threat on the screen behind him. Is a serial killer really stalking the streets of Liverpool? He gestures over his shoulder to the dark hooded male. is Liverpool's ferryman fact or fable? Staring straight into the camera, he says, "You decide." 1. Day 1. Ruth Lake was working at her desk when DCI Carver appeared at the door. He'd lost weight in the last few months, signed off as unfit for duty for the first two. A serious head injury and a bullet in the chest had put his return to work in serious doubt for a time. Yet here he was. And on the whole, he was doing okay. "What's up?" Ruth said. Carver frowned. "Not sure." Ruth lifted her chin in acknowledgement but didn't comment. With no clarification forthcoming, she said, "Want a lift home?" Carver was on a phased return to work and not yet declared fit to drive. "No." He had an otherworldly look since his injuries, a dreamy, slightly unfocused gaze, as if he permanently had something on his mind. But looks can deceive, and Ruth was one of very few who knew that in some ways Carver was sharper than he'd ever been. "So it's case related?" Ruth prompted, after he'd remained silent for another half minute.
"You could say that."
She rested her chin on her hand. "Oh, you're going to make me guess? Tell me it's another urban myth. I like those, they're fun." Carver had brought Ruth in to help with a missing persons case review. Of the 12 men who had vanished from Liverpool over the last 6 months, 4 were last seen around Bold Street and Central Station, an area of the city that had a reputation for time slips, at least among Twilight Zone enthusiasts. One local hack had even written a book on it. Carver handed her a printout of an email. The message read, "The ferryman is no fable." "Urban myth it is," she said. "Sign out a fleet car, would you?" he said. "Nothing too flash." "Okay." She turned the sheet over. "I don't see any directions. Where are we going?" He handed her a second email. It read, "Await instructions." She lifted the page to her nose and sniffed.
"I know,"
he said. "Smells like bullshit. But look at the subject line." It read, "Statistical uncertainty. Learn to think outside the box." The title of a fact or fable TV program about the disappearances. "Digitally signed F," she said. "Nice dramatic touch. Obvious wind-up." She handed the sheets back.
"Maybe. Did you watch the program?"
"Yeah."
Of course she had. Ruth was a former CSI. Science programs were her go-to TV fix at the end of a long day. Plus, Mick Tennant was a prominent statistician. She'd wanted to hear his take on their case.
"What did you think?"
Carver asked. "He rubbished the speculation, which is helpful," she said. "His main argument was that people drop out for all kinds of reasons, and the numbers of missing males were about what you'd expect in a city of 900,000 souls."
"I meant, what did you think of him?"
"He was convincing. His tone's a bit snarky, but that's Tennant's trademark." Carver nodded, still thoughtful, and she realized he'd used the past tense. "Has something happened to him?"
The day after the program went out, Tennant presented a lunchtime lecture at the Wellcome Trust in London.
Carver said he called his secretary at King's College in the Strand to let her know he'd just finished. Told her that he'd be making a short stop to meet someone on his way in, but he'd be back in time for a meeting at the university later that afternoon. "He hasn't been seen or heard from since."
"I'll have the car ready in 5 minutes," she said.
Ruth Lake watched in the rearview mirror as her boss tried to walk a straight line across the police headquarters car park. It was a valiant effort, and he almost made it, but by 6 in the evening, Greg Carver had usually exhausted his reserves of energy, and twice she saw him brush his fingers lightly along the bodywork of a parked car to steady himself. She waited in silence while he eased himself into the passenger seat and buckled up.
Do you know where we're going yet?
She said. Stone Street. Do you know it? It's near Stanley Dock.
I can get us thereabouts.
The last week in March, officially springtime. But it was already dark, and a sleety rain spattered the windscreen as they turned right, joining a slow-moving stream of commuters heading home. The first mile along the riverfront was travel brochure glossy, lit in a carefully chosen palette of blues, orange, and gold. But just past the honey-lit facade of the Liver buildings, the road darkened, their view of the water barred by a 15-foot wall. A mile farther on, Ruth glanced across at her boss. His eyes were closed.
It must be coming up soon, she said.
Detective Chief Inspector Carver checked his smartphone and directed her into a narrow, unlit street, hemmed in on both sides by crumbling 19th-century light industry units. A large storage warehouse loomed at the easterly end. Crossing a busy arterial road, they dipped down into Stone Street. A brand new commercial unit took up a sizable plot on the corner. The rest was a huddle of ancient lockups in danger of collapse. They trundled toward a railway arch, passing an abandoned car. Every window had been smashed, the wheels stolen, the roof caved in by a chunk of concrete, no doubt dumped off the railway bridge.
You sure about this? She said.
He frowned. Yes.
Any clue what we're looking for?
The message said follow the lights. Ruth noticed the slight evasiveness in his words. Carver didn't want to preempt the facts, but he was expecting something bad. She ducked her head, trying to squint up at the buildings, but the street was too narrow to see beyond the ground floor, and sleet blurred the view.
I'll have to park, she said,
glad she'd used a fleet car, and one of the low-end models, too. Even so, she rolled forward until they were under the railway arch. No point in taking chances. They walked on for 20 yards, collars turned up against a biting northeasterly. See that? Carver asked.
I see it,
Ruth said. Coloured lights pulsed up ahead. 20 yards on, they came upon a three-story 1960s commercial building. Set back from the road behind aluminium fencing, it was braced by scaffolding and swathed in plastic and tarps. Behind the sheeting, the lights phased from red to green, through blue to purple. On the first stage of scaffolding, a 12-by-10-foot section of tarp had been cut down to reveal a large wooden packing crate, open at the front. Inside the crate, they saw that the source of the light was a continuous strip of coloured LEDs. Suspended from thin wires attached to the roof of the casing, three gleaming discs of plexiglass twisted in the wind.
Gates open,
Ruth said. They moved inside the perimeter fence and took a closer look. Embedded in each disc was a flat, oval shape, convoluted at the outer edges with a void shaped like a cat snout in the center. Carver said, Jesus, is that...
Sections of brain. Human, I think.
Is it real?
I don't know.
Lake blinked against the disorientating flicker of the lights and the icy sting of sleet. The sections looked ominously organic.
Yeah, she said. I think it's real.
Carver called out, announcing their presence. No reply. He started toward a stepladder at the end of the scaffolding.
Greg,
Ruth said. His shoulders tensed, and he turned a little too loosely, compensating with a slight sideways step to the right himself. I'm fine, he said. That was debatable, but she let it go.
If it is real, the victim is way past help, she said. We need to preserve the scene.
The tension in his shoulders relaxed a little. Okay. While Carver called in scientific support, Ruth Lake headed back to the car to pick up a roll of crime scene tape. Ahead, a figure appeared out of the shadows of the railway arch, and Ruth felt a prickle of unease.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.